my co-chair's birthday, so you should wish her a happy birthday. There you go. We wanted to embarrass her. There we go. So. We didn't sing, okay.
No, please no singing.
No singing. DNSSOP does not sing.
But when the IAB chair told me this morning that I got the IAB for my birthday, I said, if we can have a successful working group meeting this afternoon, too, I'm all over that. Thank you very much.
So.
Happy birthday to you.
Oh, no.
All right, so, enough.
So you all are familiar with the note well. If not, please go read it someplace and sort of observe it. Quick agenda. Wow, that's not actually sitting on the screen very well. Oh, thank you. Took an operations guy to figure that out. So, but we're doing pretty good. We're going to cover some old business, the queue name, the root loopback, some updates on DNS terminology, some new topics on DNS metaqueries, and the mixed incremental zone transfer discussion. There's sort of a meta discussion in that one as well, which we'll get to at that point. And then, of course, the entire 6761 discussion.
Only a small piece of that.
Only a small piece of that. Basically, as we sort of mentioned on the list, we're going to have a virtual meeting. We'd like to have a virtual meeting in a few weeks to sort of hit on those and sort of dig into all six drafts in various details. We're going to discuss there's three currently on the agenda today. There'll be very short discussions, because they're very directed into what's going on. And then some new business, as we're going to have some folks that have some stuff they want to sort of discuss as well. I'm going to try to figure out what's going on there. Basically, just an update, we do have the list of documents. Paul Hoffman's been tracking. I know he stopped sending the notifications out, but most of that is because I fell off the map for a little bit, and I take responsibility for that. So we do have a lot of stuff in flight. I did send out a status email earlier today that listed all the things that we have adopted and where things are. And so if you have signed up for reviews, please do so. A few things have sort of popped back up. So definitely, we're going to keep moving things along. And definitely thank you for helping on the reviews. So just a few quick topics on the client subnet. There was some discussion today about the draft in among itself. They want to change it to basically document current operational practice and then essentially revisit it for sort of new work and possibly get a new code point. So we're going to sort of discuss some of that. And also, at the bottom, I kind of put their GitHub repository where they've been tracking a lot of those issues. So if you don't see some of the discussion on the mailing list, you should track the GitHub repository, and you can track a lot of the issues as well. On the DNS cookie discussion, that's one of the documents. There is one open question about the error code in the option field. I know Mark has brought it up, and Mark and Donald both have, I think, different opinions on what should happen there. But we're going to definitely try to push that along, get some input from folks, and I think we're ready for working group last call on that once we sort of, make a decision on that. And then 5966 BIS, if you don't see a lot of discussion on the mailing list, it's because they're tracking a lot of it through the GitHub issue tracker. And so there's the link to the GitHub, watch that, figure out what's going on. There's been some good stuff going on in there. Not everybody's pleased by all the things that are being done, but that's DNSSOP, and so our job is to sort of, as chairs, is to sort of, sort all those sort of things out and kind of come to some good conclusion on that. And that's on our side. So we tried to make our stuff as short as possible because we know we have a lot of stuff going on, and so we'll just jump right into the big topics, which is Stefan and the queue name work.
Yeah. Before we go any further, we have blue sheets out there, so don't forget about the blue sheets. That's how we get these nice big rooms to put lots of people in. Also, we had, I don't think we finalized JabberScribe and NoteTaker. We had a volunteer NoteTaker. Okay, we have a NoteTaker and JabberScribe. Jared has JabberScribe. Please don't forget at the microphone to give your name to help out the scribe and the folks remotely.
Thank you. Okay, hello everyone. I won't explain QNAP minimization, you already know, but there are still three questions that have been raised at various stages in the discussion, and for which I would be happy to have some input for the working group. The first one is that about negative consequences of QNAP minimization. Nothing is free in this world. Security is always a trade-off, etc., etc. And some people said that QNAP minimization, you have with QNAP minimization less data. Of course, it's a point. But today in the draft 02, there is a mention in section 3 about the fact that yes, if you have less data, you have less data, and it can be a problem in some case. Do we consider that it is a sufficient warning today, or should we add something more detailed explaining that when you minimize data, some services will be affected? So that's the first point. Second question, should we hide the queue type? In the current text in draft 02, we always send a request with queue type NS, or if the case there is a middle box that does not react properly, we can send a record because it's a less revealing. Some people said that it deprives you of interesting statistics about the percentage of queue types, A versus quad A, deployment of SRV, etc. So a possible solution could be to keep the original queue type, so minimize only the queue name, but keep the original queue type. Is it a good idea or not? Should we mention it, etc.? That's the second question. On the third one, today, 02 is a bit complicated. There are two algorithms, one aggressive one, which is always minimize or only send the shortest queue name possible. On a second one, a lazy one, where we send the full queue name at the beginning, then we switch to an aggressive mode after the cache is filled in. The second algorithm is not really well specified. It can even be said it's not specified at all. Also, some people mentioned other possible optimizations, such as treating the route specially, treating IP6.RPAR specially, because it's typically a case where you have many domains without a zone cut. So basically, should we mention possible optimization? Should we mention only one way? Should we have one way preferred on the other in an appendix? This sort of thing. It would be interesting to have some opinions from the working group about it. And that's all. I said three questions. You have three questions. Now the floor is yours.
Paul Hoffman. So one of the concerns that was brought up on the list I think we need to keep in mind for all three of these is the benefit of QNAME minimization is on privacy for a user sending queries. All of these optimizations and, oh, we're losing data, the benefits of those are for other people. So what you're asking us to do is to weigh less privacy for better data collection. Less privacy affects the user, better data collection really doesn't help the user nearly as much as it helps maybe people in this room. And therefore, I think it's an apple and oranges comparison. I'm not saying I know which way to go, but we're not saying with less privacy for the user gets this additional value. It's these other people get this additional value.
I mostly agree with you, except for the third point, because in that case, if you use the lazy algorithm, yes, mm-hmm. you leak more data, but it can be you can have also a faster response, less latency at the beginning, so a small benefit for the user. Otherwise,
possibly.
I agree with you.
Only for uncached data, though.
The trade-off is complicated because it's a trade-off between different actors who do not have the same interest.
Dice making. If the idea of this is to dine, if the idea of this is to give privacy to the users, then I think we should prefer the aggressive one and make that explicit. And if there are drawbacks of that because it's more latency, we can list that as well, but I think we should keep in mind what the goal is here, what we're trying to achieve, and then pick the better solution.
Evan Hunt, ISC. I just wanted to agree with that last point thoroughly. I don't see a lot of point to specifying the lazy method if this is a draft that is explaining how to improve privacy. We can include, you know, considerations for optimizations and things like that, but it's what we're doing here is we're saying here is a standard interoperable way of improving privacy, and that seems to me to be the thing that we ought to focus on.
Hello, my name is Alexander Tsuk. I'm an IIT fellow from Ukraine. Maybe my question is not so close to discussion, but are there any suggestions about how to optimize IDN, ccTLDs, and DNS network? Because there is a developing industry in this issue. Thank you.
Excuse me, you will have to explain in more details. In what way is it a special case? Why is it different?
IDN, for example, Cyrillic domains or Arabic domains.
I know what IDN is.
There should be some optimization for such service.
Such as? Because right now, off the top of my head, I don't see why they should be treated specially, but I need the explanations, I'm afraid.
For example, it's we have problems with the left side of IDN email. Oh, it doesn't work at all. And there is a issue how to develop IDN, for example, moving from Punycode to developing Unicode. So it's more broader questions that your agenda, but maybe.
IDN are not mentioned at all in the current draft because it seemed to me that they didn't raise any specific issue for the problem of QNAME minimization. But if I'm wrong, I'm willing to listen, but I'm afraid it will have to be more detailed. I'm sorry.
So it sounds like what people seem to be looking for is to pick privacy over data collection or other issues.
Yes.
And if there's any sort of counter to that, it should, you know, people should say something to the list. But I think that's the direction you should be going at, Stephane. Okay.
Yeah, do you have the input you need to go ahead with the questions?
Yeah,
thank you.
Paul, are you gonna? Yep, wasn't sure if that was you or Warren.
For all of three slides. So this is the draft that has already been being discussed on the mailing list. A real quick history, since it's actually one of the active drafts. It started off as an interview draft. We turned it into a working group draft after Hawaii when people said that they wanted the working group. We've done a 0-1 based on, there was a fair amount of discussion between both at Hawaii and since Hawaii once we turned in the new draft. Basically, these are the changes we made between the initial draft and this one is to say we know that this is not a recommended practice. We said that in the document. We're going to say it in a few more places because people were concerned that, oh, someone's going to read this and think they should implement it. If we need to say that at the beginning of every paragraph, that may be a little bit too much, but that we think that now it has, you know, enough places that say, this is not what we're recommending. This is if you wanted to get this result, this is a way to do it. And we talked a little bit more about, and if you think it's just going to work, that's great, but boy, are you going to be in a world of pain if it fails. And so we actually talked some more about the failure cases there. So at this point, it is meant to be an informational RFC. Some people would like it to be a best practice document. Our feeling, Warren, my feeling sort of is that there are fewer of those people than people who want it to be informational, so the word best doesn't appear at the top. And that seems to be what people are churning on, is that. So this is the IETF, so process always takes, you know, precedence over actual technology. So once we get done with that, maybe we can, you know, figure out whatever the last little technical nits are. There was one suggestion that since our document explicitly says that this would be on the loopback interface of a device, and some people are saying, well, it doesn't have to be. You can just set up a local route that a few other local people can use. That's fine. You can do that. We aren't going to mention that in the document. For one thing, that will confuse things, and also I would, now that's sliding into my mind into worse, you know, current practice, because at that point none of those people really know how to use. And some of this came out. There was a workshop in Hong Kong in December, and there were a lot of side conversations on that. So we don't see sufficient support for this. We would like just to leave it as no. We're really, you know, technically talking about this is on the loop back of one box. So if you are administering this box, you are responsible for what's on the loopback. There's no question about, oh, well, I'm not the administrator of that. And the last thing we're waiting on is someone said that Power DNS should now be able to do this, and someone else said, yes, that's true, and I will admit that I suck at Power DNS configuration, so I'm waiting for someone to give me the configuration. Do I want to perform auto HV keystroke correction? Yes. Which was the greater than sign. This is the last slide. If the working group agrees on, or the working group needs to come to agreement on the status, that should be easy. That should be quick, not easy. And any more wording changes that we need, great. And then we think we're done. I mean, that's up to the working group chairs, but we think we're done.
No, we tend to agree. It's just the informational. We agree it's informational over best practice, but if we see an outpouring of best practice support, we're willing to consider that.
So I have a short set of slides and I make it go blind. Great. Okay. Yep.
So
terminology subtract.
Yeah, but I didn't see any slides on that.
Correct.
Because you have it right there. Okay, perfect.
Because we don't need no damn slides if it's going to be fast.
That's right.
Jeff, are you talking about loopback?
Yep.
Okay, great.
Good.
Very quick question. It's a design question. I just want to know why you're effectively instantiating two DNS resolvers in one box to effectively pass information from one part of the box's memory to another part of the box's memory.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like an awfully long path to go across a memory boundary. What was the design consideration that said, I want two resolver instances rather than one where one resolver says, I'm authoritative for the root and I'm also a recursive resolver for other things?
We didn't want to say you must run bind. Seriously, that was mine. Warren, do you have a better explanation?
And another thing, if you set it up with the name server's authoritative for the root, it doesn't actually do DNSSEC validation when it queries, you know, if it serves it directly. This forces it to do its own DNSSEC validation. And yes, I'm sure software could be changed, but
something's messed up.
I think they're tweaking it. We have an AD for this.
Right. So let's see if Joel is as good as Stuart was last night. Yes, he was. And yes, you are. Very cool.
That's right. Yay.
So Joel, are you now working for Epson?
I spent a lot of time in high school aiming projectors.
As did 3/4 of the people in this
room. Yeah. Maybe also stuffed in a locker.
Bill?
Bill Manning. I think that this is probably a reasonable document to proceed as informational. It certainly isn't best practice. And if you're going to do this and you're going to use bind, you're going to take the memory hit, Jeff. We're not optimizing in the localhost. And if we are, get a better smartphone. So there are some downsides to doing this, and it might be useful if you're going to proceed to actually enumerate someplace the caveats and warnings as to why this is not a best practice.
We have those already. Did we miss some that you wanted? I'm sorry, have you read the draft?
I have read the draft.
Okay.
I have read at least two versions of the draft. I, in fact, made comments before.
Yeah.
I have...
So if
perhaps
we're missing,
not seeing your current version, but
it's been out since January. So I'm not saying we have enough. If you, in reading that, don't see enough caveats and warnings, by all means, let the list know that those would be, you know, very good things for us to add.
If there was a way for the RFC editor to take a big red quarantine diagonally across the document, that would be a good place for it.
There's not. And I say that as the author of the V3 format for the RFC editor. actually, we can't even have red because of colorblind people. So are we done on that?
Yes.
And so you want to put on an empty slide or just...
We'll leave it.
So anyway, so the terminology document, we don't have any slides on because this will be really quick. It's still an individual document. It seems like people like the document or like the idea of having the document. We keep getting suggestions for new terms, which is good, but some of them are made-up terms. So it's like, oh, no one really uses this term, but we figured after reading the document that this is a good differentiation. We're not so happy with making up terms right now. We're not saying we can't do that, but those would be better done in separate documents. We do keep getting improvements on the current definitions. That's great, because in fact we've gotten some of them a little bit wrong, or we've gotten them right for a part of this room, and a larger part of the room says, no, that's not the way we think about them, and that's exactly what we want in the document. Anytime that a DNS term is being commonly used in two even slightly different ways, we should be documenting that. That is exactly what this is for. This is not the DNS police saying, when you use this term, you must mean this. It is definitely, if you're using this term this way, please understand that other people might be using it this way as well. Some people have actually tried to make this document change some of the standards. No, we're just not going to do that. No, not going to happen. So we would be happy if this was a working group document and it was published soon. And there are other documents that are now starting to refer to this, and they are well ahead. And so one thing we're talking about that we would really like to see is possibly, as long as this document is correct, even if it's not complete, even if people are going to keep thinking of new terms to add later, maybe we publish this as an RFC now, as long as it's right, even if it's not complete, and we do an update later. And later could even mean 1 year. Issuing an RFC is not something that means things can never change. And in fact, there is IETF has a history for terminology documents of issuing them and then issuing updates not that much later. And I am the author of one of those. The internationalization terminology document got updated when people had really thought about it more and said, oh, but we're using things differently. So maybe we actually do that, get it out the door as an RFC as long as it's right, and then add stuff later. That's it. Therefore, no slides.
Bill?
Yep.
So I get to continue to use belt and suspenders, right?
Yes, but
instead of hints or...
I'm not sure I would want to get in the way of you using belts and suspenders. Why are you asking that?
There are a number of places where data is modified, added, changed with some periodicity that doesn't show up in an RFC. RFCs have increasingly become difficult to get published. And so some people look at an IANA registry as a way to do this. So would this be better served as an IANA registry?
No.
I'm hearing a lot of no's, and certainly I'm hearing that from right about here in me.
Andrew Sullivan, expletive deleted no.
Right. We heard one of the expletives over here, so. Right.
This is a terminology document, and Paul just finished saying that actually it's not that hard to get an RFC out the door if you just do it. So I want to say something a little stronger than the way Paul put it. Please look at this document. If there are definitions in here that are controversial, we can remove them from the draft that gets published, and we should get this one with the complete and true definitions in it out the door as quickly as possible, because we can continue to work on another one and update it. But I think there are already enough references of other drafts to this thing that it would be foolish not to publish it as quickly as possible, because people are going to depend on this. The alternative, of course, is they're going to define these terms in very slightly different ways in multiple RFCs, and that's worse.
Right. And in fact, if we get it out soon, it will cause people to start thinking of, oh, let's not even try to define things, let's just point at that. So it's not just the ones that are referring to it now, there are other ones more. So that's our thought. We'll see if the working group agrees.
Yeah, Joel Yeagley.
Or if the AD agrees.
Consider for a moment that the population of this room is about a third of the total active participants on the IETF mailing list. And consider then, therefore, how easy it is to go from working group last call to IETF last call, and you know, have the opinions in this room actually be moderately representative of the community as at large, right? So if we actually have enough momentum behind it to get it out of here, I think we have enough thrust to get it to the ISG.
Mm-hmm. And remember, other areas are going to want this. I mean, when I did the internationalization definitions document, people from routing were like, oh, wow, that's really cool. We never knew what those meant. And fortunately, they don't need to know what it meant, but it still was helpful. So let's do it.
And the chairs have discussed this, since you guys have done so many good iterations of it.
Okay.
If we did adopt it, we would adopt it and probably immediately do a working group last call with the standard cycle, not sort of dragging it out.
Okay.
Because the mailing list has been very actively involved. You've gotten great, you know, feedback. You've turned the document several times.
And I've got a small queue of additions right now, but yeah.
So that would be our opinion. It is adopted and immediately do a working group last call and start that 2 to 3 week cycle and just sort of, you know, get it through, because Joel's right. If we can agree on it, it's like it's out the door. Mm-hmm. You know.
Good. So yeah, great. Thank you.
So we'll probably send that out to the mailing list later on this week, but that was sort of our idea about adopting it, unless the authors felt that it was going to take too long. Okay. So that gives us, now we come to the more interesting part of the more meta discussion.
Sir. Yeah, there's been a lot of discussion on the list, and in fact there's an active call for adoption, and what we're looking for is some guidance on where we're at in that discussion and also where people want it to go, and we will.
Okay. When you're walking down the street and somebody walks up to you and asks you what time it is, you're likely to give them an answer. If somebody walks up to you on the street and asks you, what is in your wallet? What is your answer?
Nothing.
Basically, people want to avoid answering the question or get some credentials. And that's what this is about. From an authoritative server's perspective, there are times when we want not to answer a query from a certain entity or everybody. There can be various reasons for it. You can question them. Sometimes we have no choice, sometimes they may leak information. So basically, there are some of us have been getting together and talking about this, and we would like to do it in a way that is uniform, preferably standard, and most of all, avoid breakage. So here are some options. Lots of people today are dropping queries that they don't like, which means that the resolvers keep going to everybody and keep asking the same questions. Sometimes they will return it and have the TC bit set and an empty answer, which means that if it is a forged query, you don't get anything back, but it adds extra latency for resolvers that have a legitimate reason to do it. Some people sent back a code that refused. I proposed using notDIMP in some of these cases. Caused a little bit of a heat here and there. Mild on DNS scale. There are others. You can just send it back a no error, empty data. May not work. We could send back the null type. That would poison caches or resolvers so they don't ask the same question again. Or we can invent a new query, a new typeout that says, we're not answering this. So these are options. Tell us what you want us to write in the document so it gets so it's not harmful. Or tell us to go away.
I have to say that I'm against the idea of saying go away, just because what you're trying to do is document operational practice, which is kind of what I think we're here for, but that's just my opinion, and I want to hear from the room.
Okay, go back one slide. Paul Rogers. So I'm a little confused. I didn't closely follow the storm of any emails on the list, but these last few ones, don't they break DNSSEC by having some sort of unverified answer back that I cannot trust, that someone could spoof?
No. Not necessarily.
Okay, then I'll go read the broadcast storm on the list.
If you're signing online, there's no issue. If you and sometimes there are certain types you may want to. Yeah.
Evan, if you're answering Paul, go for it.
I was. Evan Hunt, ISC. I think the idea was that if the zone is signed, then what you return is the NSEC or the NSEC 3 covering that node to indicate that there is no any type present, but not returning any of the other data. If the zone is not signed, then you would either volunteer a new type code or send a null type code.
Or an R code.
No data doesn't mean no RSS.
Yes, that is correct. No, sorry. That third line from the bottom, no data, the reason that I objected to that was that it would be indistinguishable from an empty non-terminal.
Mm-hmm.
And consequently, it would cause caches to be poisoned to think that there was no data at that node rather than that we're simply not answering any. If we volunteer just null, it comes back looking as if, okay, we have some data at that node. All we have so far is null. We're going to have to go actually ask all the questions to find out what the real data is.
Null is a record.
Yeah, null, the reason for null is simply that it's already specified. We don't have to get a new type code for it, and it sort of intuitively means what we're saying. But any non-defined yet type code would be fine.
Yeah, and this is not the next full list of possibilities.
Paul Hoffman, three things. The chair's asked, do we think it's ready for adoption? I don't think it's ready for adoption for the same reason I said on the list that never got replied to, which is the motivation section in the current draft is wrong. What you just said now is you don't need a specific motivation, just any motivation will do. That's a reasonable answer, and you should rip out the motivations from the current draft.
Done.
Yeah. second is I am very hesitant to hook the RRSIG in the same bucket as I don't want to give something specific because that will be confusing, even though it's one of the ones that you could give this to. Just like if an authoritative server sees an RRSIG query and looks in and goes, oh, this is one of the ones I want to do this for, that's fine, but I don't think it should be called out as a meta query. Because it isn't listed really meta query-ish as it is currently, and I don't want to redefine that just for this, especially if we're going to go to motivation any. And the third is I don't understand why, I agree with Paul Wouters. I think the last two, where you're actually going to send an R-type, that means it should have been signed. You're saying I've got a record in here with this R-type. So at that point, I mean, anything can be spoofed, you know, anyone can make up things that can be spoofed, but now you're saying I have an unsigned record in a signed zone.
Not
that feels tricky to me.
That depends on what your signing systems are. Online signers have no problem with it. You can pre-populate these if you want.
So I'm fine if you say pre-populate if you want. I mean, the world has extremely few online signers, but I think the world thinks in terms of 4033, 4034, 4035 as pre-populated. So you might say you might pre-populate these and send the signatures.
Evan Hunt again. My assumption is that if we're doing the last two things, that's only going to be for zones that are not signed. where it is possible to synthesize a response without having to mess with DNS sec validation. If the zone is signed, then you've got an NSEC or a covering NSEC 3 that you can respond with.
Ralph Abernom, out of these, I think answering with TC has large implications. Asking resolver actually is legitimate, so in the case of the random subdomains attack, this would kind of actually be a DDoS attack itself. And I think the last one are really is the one to go.
Peter?
Peter Kordinik. On the question, on the question of adoption, I'm not really sure that the problem is well specified. I at least don't really understand what exact problem we're trying to solve here. There's a variety of those that probably need different documents, deprecating any as a usual query type or something. The problem I see here is that we seem to be at the boundary between policy and protocol. And while the general assumption is that an authoritative server is responding to queries one way or another, primarily with the data it has available, we probably do have precedent that we do have precedent that some servers don't respond to all the queries, AXFR being the primary example. But that is a policy decision. If you want, you can do that today. You can also decide no longer to respond to A queries.
So, Peter, if I ask you a question, how do
refuse.
Bart, we don't have to. Yeah.
You got the point? The motivation needs to be much clearer. And I'm not really convinced that it is the IETF's role to give one-offs or justification for policy decisions that you maybe want to take the heat for. And of course, even if you refuse to respond to certain query types, I'm a bit old-fashioned. I want something that is architecturally consistent. Lying about the data that is in there is, again, although it is a policy decision, is probably not the best way to go. So just refuse. Just say no.
So Peter, it's Joe here. I jumped the queue. I'm a co-author. I'm allowed to do that. So on the motivations thing, what I'd heard from some other people and what I thought myself was kind of the opposite. I think the situation is some people block particular queue types, and that happens. And it happens today, and it's been happening for a while. The goal of this draft is not to explain why you should do that or to deprecate any or any other queue type. It's to say, if you do decide to block a particular queue type, how should you do it to make the life of clients as easy as possible so they can understand what's happening?
So, some people beat their children. I'm not sure that the wisest response to that is to document the best possible way of beating your children.
You want the child to understand that it's being beaten.
According to protocol, of course.
And I know there's been some discussion of the IETF needing an ombuds team.
Yeah, but only for participants. The children don't participate. The point is, how much can we specify things that actually already happen outside of the protocol? This isn't the first time that we hear, yes, we know this is broken, but we want people to understand how broken they are, we want people to operate brokenness to certain rules. There's a very old, I guess it was never published as an RFC, but Keith Moore, decades ago, wrote an internet draft, which is one of my favorites, standardizing drunk driving on the internet. Recommended reading.
Marco Sanz, Denik. From my point of view and from the reading of RFC 1035, the correct answer for your use case is ERCOL 5. So I just don't understand why you want to update RFC 1035. ERCOL refuse. That's it.
ERCOL 3, you mean? No, there are 5, yes. 5.
Okay. Endless. Okay, so this discussion started with the any queries being a problem. And that became meta queries that you didn't want to answer to. And then now it's
I don't want to talk to you about that. It's kind of like it's changed the scope over time, and it's fine with that. The reason why it came up here was that the last two only work for the any query. Right, so that's what made me jump up here. So those two would only work if it's the any query you're worried about, because they have to match, the answer has to match the question for this to even matter. And DSX signing is not a problem. I can sign everything. That's no big deal. Let's go to your main. But going back to this, I've been involved with all these kind of fights over time, and I've seen lots of non-standard implementations. When you ask them questions for something, for the A record, you get back an answer. For anything else, no response at all. These are obviously non-standard, and you wouldn't worry about them normally. But the thing is, it's cobbled up implementations that want to answer like, just for the A record for whatever reason there is out there. And this happens in some of the popular lists of all the top URLs I see out there somewhere. So I think the question really is here is, how does someone react to an R code that's not no error? Because we talk about this all the time. If you get back R code refused, do you then go to another server for that same answer? Not do I go to another server, or do I, you know, basically you want to have an R code that says, don't bother, you're not going to get the answer. The authority of the zone says there's no answer for your question. Or it's a server policy, but the server doesn't want to deal with the traffic. These are two different things, because I may go to one server and say, you know, I don't want to answer it, but you go over here, you'll get the answer from somebody else, because for whatever reason, the operator of the server is more willing to do AXR, for example, than the other ones. So this actually happens across the board. So the thing we want to do with the R codes is, what's the expected reaction of the receiver of the R code not equal no error? What should they do in all cases? You know, NX domain, obviously, they're told the name's not there, don't go anywhere else. But that's not appropriate for what you want to do if it's a certain queue type. But you want to say, don't ask, don't even try. That's what you want an R code to do. I think you have to key on that. What's the reaction to an R code on this list? It's good, and which one you answer back is going to depend on what the question was and the reason why you want not answer. So,
basically, I think for most resolvers that when they get something that is not R code 0 or R code 3, they try another server.
Right, and perhaps, honestly, I don't know that the R code reaction is formally codified anywhere, and perhaps we want to do that. And of course, you know, clarifications of R code behavior is going to be a clarifications, and I've done a few of those. So
Ed, that's two different bits of work, potentially. They could be in the same document, but they could also be in separate documents. One of them is guidance to clients as to how do you behave in the face of particular R codes. One is how do you behave as a server if you want to indicate a particular motivation for answering in a particular way.
Yeah. And certainly, and to get back to the working group adoption, I would say it's probably not ready for adoption as a document as of now because of that. I think maybe it is these two pieces of work.
We have a couple more people, and we're cutting the mic line now, but we do want everybody to get their say.
Yep. Stuart? Stuart Cheshire, Apple. Ed missed the case of home gateways where if the queue type is A, they answer it. If it's any other type, they crash and then don't answer any more queries. I agree with Peter Cox's comments.
No, that is the first option.
and answer no more, is that? I agree with Peter. I'm going to make this quick so no short on time. I agree with Peter's comment that understanding the motivation for why you'd want to do this, I think, is helpful, because if we publish an RFC, there's a risk it then gets circulated and interpreted as a recommendation. My vote for this, as many other people have said, is refused, because that seems like the semantically correct result. In particular, R-type is null is wrong, because the null record doesn't mean the M-record. It means null type, not null content. It's I know software. Without commentary, I know software that treats it as a void star type, meaning you could attach any bag of up to 64K data to this. I've seen JPEG images stored in the DNS as null records. So null is not an appropriate thing.
Mark?
I've been thinking about this for years, because we had to deal with this in AMD, because we don't implement some of the meta types. We currently return not imp for the mail, whatever the mail one is. This is a very hard question, and I don't think there is a good answer. unfortunately. When you don't implement a regular query type, it's very simple. You return an NX domain or no error, no data. And servers which get that wrong should be taken out and shot. But this one is very hard. This is a very hard question. And I don't really care whether it's refused, not imp, or we come up with a new type which says if you actually configure this, you are telling the world that all the name servers for this zone will refuse the query. And that might be the answer. Okay, might come up a new R code. And it is explicitly designed to be cached along with an SOA record. So it's a different, it's something different to NX domain. But it's a policy decision which is a per zone policy decision, not a per server zone, per server. Refused and not a per server.
So Mark, the obvious question there is what does a client do when it receives an R code it doesn't know about?
At the moment, with refused and not imp, we go on and try a different name server because refused is a bad delegation.
Sure, but suppose I'm running bind 9.6, which is old enough that doesn't imagine a new R code for this.
At the moment, you'll mostly get back serve file, which is perfectly fine for the old code. If it gets serve file, that's fine. I don't care about that. You're not giving back an answer that I can use anyway. But we want new servers, a new result, recursive servers, and new stub clients to be able to have something which is cacheable, which has got a time to live, and will go back without going trying everything. So, yes, a new R code which says I'm not answering this, but this is a per zone policy.
Thank you. Rob?
So I think we're getting a bit off track here. I mean, while I would like to have an ideal solution with a specific R code, and I don't think it is in our charter, and what Suzanne said initially, we are talking about documenting what certain players are currently doing, and they're doing it for a reason, because otherwise the internet would be flawed or not working because of all these queries that are mostly malicious use. So I think if we document with that draft what we and what a lot, number of large players are thinking is a good thing to do, then we should be okay.
We have an open call for adoption on the list, and there's actually a great deal of input here. That frankly, what I was thinking is that what we want to do is sort of consider this really wide-ranging input between here and what's on the list and get back to the list with how we might want to proceed. Okay. If that works for you.
We're willing to write down whatever the group says is a good way to do it. We're not wedded to any one solution. I think I can speak for both of us.
Yeah. And that's terrific, and thanks everybody for all the input, and we just sort of have to figure out what it means and what the way forward is, but I think that's going to take some thinking and some consideration offline.
Minimal IXFRs. So we got IXFRs, which is full zone transfer. It's quite big, so if you want to make a small change, doesn't make sense to send the whole zone again. So we came up with IXFR, which is in RFC 9095. So it's more efficient, but there are some issues. And we encountered some drawbacks, and the first one is this. If you have DNSSEC, and you're doing resigning on a fairly static zone, you are sending updates with basically a SOA and these add these signatures and delete these signatures. Or if you're doing a small change in an RR set, you also list the whole signature you have to delete, which is something you already know, because if you change the RR set, you have to delete that signature, right? So the draft I came up with is just some ideas, proposals, how to make IXFRs smaller.
The main thing is this RSIC deletion, and it's a big win. But there are also like DNS update kind of styles logic we can add. We can use the class to define some more logic and make the zone transfers even smaller. Another drawback is if you have lots of zones which share the same infrastructure, which all do zone transfers, you open a lot of connections. So also feels a little bit inefficient, so to say. So maybe we want to come up with something more efficient and do multiple zones over one connection, or one long-lived TCP connection, so to say. Actually, I covered the proposals already in the drawbacks. So Mixer is a superset of IXFR, so it should be backwards compatible. The same way that IXFR is to AXFR. And I think the changes I propose has a fairly low deployment cost. And the other one, as I said, we can say we can use a long-lived TCP connection to do the multiple zone transfers over one connection instead of opening 10,000 connections for all zones. And if we do that, we can do that on a different port, for example. We can do all kinds of wild stuff, and we don't really have to stick to the DNS format, which might be fun. A lot of alternatives are which came on the list or in private emails. Like you can do packet compression. Sure, you can do that packet compression. You have more generic algorithms who can probably do better compression than we can in our heads. But on the other hand, we know about the DNS logic, and and those compression algorithms don't compress crypto very well. And another thing that's being done quite much, I believe, I heard in the field, is that just outside the DNS doing rsync. But rsync, if you have a lot of zones which change a lot of times, that requires a lot of configuration. So we would like to come up with something that has discovery mechanism as well. And here's the question. Do you think this is actually something we should investigate? Maybe not here, maybe not in DNSOP, but is it something worthwhile working on?
Yeah, I know the question was raised by the authors that this work may be outside the scope of the charter, even with the new, you know, modified DNSOP charter. And so that's something that we should, you know, if anybody has opinions either way, we'd like to hear that. With the idea being that if it's out of scope, then there could be some narrowly defined mechanism, you know, working group or sub-working group to sort of attack this problem if there is enough interest in it. And I know I brought this up to our wonderful AD and Casey Hanney, any sort of wisdom he wanted to share with us.
No.
He does not, okay. And no opinions, it seems like, from the room? Whether or not, you know. We can do a hum. How about a quick hum? Do we think it's actually applicable to the working group? Not whether or not it's useful or we're going to adopt it, but just whether or not, you know, it's inside the scope of the working group as it is.
I would really like maybe input hum or mic whether people think this is something worthwhile pursuing.
Okay.
Before we decide.
Okay.
Where.
So let's do that. Let's get a hum to say if people find this useful, please hum. And do people not find this useful? Okay, so it seems like there's an acceptance that it is useful work, if versus non-useful work. If we could have a hum, whether or not it's applicable to the working group, can we have a hum for that? Okay, it doesn't sound like it's applicable to a working group then. Oh, the question, okay, sorry, I'm sorry. Is it in charter? Please hum yes if you think it's in charter. Mm-hmm. And no? Okay, so again, yes, so slight agreement. So, okay, so we do think it's in charter. We do want to approach it. It seems like it's useful. And we can approach whether or not we want to do a call for adoption or do more research on this on the mailing list. So at least nobody sort of saying violently, no, this is horrible work, which I think is, you know.
So it's not clear to me that with this in mind, if this would be pursued within DNSSOP, or if we're maybe we're thinking of maybe spinning off short-lived working group as well, which maybe makes sense and have a very narrow charter.
Andrew Sullivan, I think this work is in the working group's charter. If this work is not in the working group's charter, then this should go to a BOF, or you got to find a an AD or something like that. I don't think that this working group is competent to decide whether this ought to spin up a different working group. That's something that we can't decide here.
Yeah, and I do know that there's concern that there's too much work in flight, which someone could say is a crisis of success, which may be another reason why, you know, they view this as sort of an other option. So,
Andrew Sullivan again. I want to point out that earlier Paul was up there and you were observing how, like, we've managed to make all kinds of progress on this document because people have been reviewing it and sending things, and it doesn't really matter if we move all the machinery of, like, you know, have we adopted this and blah blah.
Yeah.
And instead the question is, if people are doing the work on this, then it's going to be ready and we can push it ahead. And I think this working group is completely chartered to work on this thing. The real question is, are people going to do it rather than fuss about, you know, exactly which order we're going to follow all of the bureaucratic procedures.
It seems to me that we have two separate issues here. One is doing the bureaucratic machinery, which we will discuss, you know, as the chairs where you brought this, we will discuss with the, with, you know, RAD and you, and we'll work on that. However, that has nothing to do with whether, you know, we do have an interest in the room, people want to pursue the discussion. When we spun out DPRIVE, what we did was started with some drafts in this group. As the interest developed and we went through the details and so on, we were actively working on the documents. So the fact that we don't know exactly what we're going to do with this work shouldn't stop people from reviewing the document, engaging on what should happen here. Don't get distracted by the machinery.
Clear. Thanks.
Yeah. No, thank you.
I might need my little 6761 slide. And because I sinned in a former life in ways I wish I remembered, we have actually had some discussion. We have a number of... Go ahead. Next slide, please. The working group has been challenged a couple of times now since we rechartered, such that RFC 6761 and applications for registry changes under 6761 have been on charter for us, and we have had a fair amount of interest in that. There are several drafts, and there's been, you know, discussion of a number of other things that people are considering submitting as drafts, and some questions about how to apply 6761 in the real world. We have discussed, you know, among ourselves and with many members of the working group, with RAD, for people that are interested in this set of topics, it's really interesting and important, and for people that aren't, it isn't. And we've been looking at how can we engage on this successfully without it eating the working group alive. So what we're doing is we are, next slide please, we are working on details for an interim working group meeting, which, you know, if you're familiar with the IETF rules, is a real working group meeting. It's just we do it virtually to discuss 6761 applicability. Some of the questions here, you know, strike some of us as interesting, but it's really for the working group to decide what the issues are. We have also given time today to a couple of drafts, Onion for the Dot Onion request, which has a timeliness concern that will be explained. Draft Chapin, which is on a set of labels, Home, Corp, and Mail, has actually been kicking around and very patiently waiting for us to recharter. So we thought we would make sure we got a little time in for that. The Dot Alt draft, which also has been, you know, was waiting for us to recharter, attempts to address a larger portion of the problem space than a single label. But the goal of discussing all of these here is to try to develop the conversation for the interim, which we are looking at having in the third week of April. We'll do some work on the list, making sure that we can do this, but we are working towards doing a more comprehensive treatment of this topic than is really feasible when we have all these other things that we're also trying to do as the working group in a face-to-face. So I guess, Richard, you're up.
All right, I'm supposed to stand in the box.
Yes.
How much time do I have?
I'll try to be brisk. I think 10 minutes is what we said.
Yeah, so this is about .onion, which I think a lot of folks in this room have probably heard of before. So I'd like to present a little bit of a quick refresher on what .onion names are, what 6761 lays out as criteria for special use names, and then look at how these two match against each other, and then explain a little bit the timeliness concern that Suzanne noted. So .onion names, so they're tied to Tor. So .onion names label Tor hidden services. Syntactically, they're of the form, basically a hash of an entity's public key, .onion. And the idea is that to use a .onion name, you do some resolution protocol that the Tor protocol supports, and then you connect to this service through the Tor protocol. So right now, okay, we're off the internet, I guess. That's it. Right now, there are about 30,000 of these names, and traffic to those names comprises about 1% of Tor's bandwidth overall. Also, the other notable stat on the slide is the roughly 1 million daily users, which sort of gives you a sense of the usage of this name right now. A couple of examples here. Facebook managed to iterate through public keys till they got one that came out to Facebook core www.i.onion. Magic of, I think it was Hadoop they did that with. But more commonly, things look like the random strings down at the bottom here. So, refresher on 6761. 6761 says if this name is special, then it is a special use name. Namely, if it is not used, if it looks like a DNS name but is not actually used with the DNS. And it defines several categories of specialness that a name can require. So, drawing from 6761's registration of .test here, you know, some things are, there's some categories where there's nothing special about .test. Users and application software should treat .test names like any others, but name servers should treat it differently. So how do these two line up? Well, .onion is pretty special. As I mentioned before, it's only usable in the context of Tor. It only labels Tor hidden services. You can't resolve it through the DNS. You have to resolve it through Tor itself. So the desire here is to have is to note this and have things fail fast. So, you know, one would expect that trying to look this up in the DNS would result in an X domain because it doesn't label a DNS thing. And application software should expect to get that negative result. So I'm just sort of going through the categories that 6761 defines as special handling. Even starting from the user, there's some differentness here because .onion names are used to indicate Tor hidden services which have different user level, application level security properties than other services. At the application level, we would like applications to sort of get a double check mark because they need to not only resolve these names differently, but connect to the services differently. So it's two levels of differences for applications. And then at the level of the DNS, we need, if you're going to try and resolve this, you need to resolve it with Tor or you need to fail. And if you're a DNS thing, like a caching resolver, an authoritative server, or an operator or registry, you just need to fail this thing, say, agree that it is not part of the DNS and indicate that in your responses. So all of these are very, different from how you handle domain names, so it seems to make sense, it seems like a good match between .onion names and 6761. So let's talk about this timeliness concern. The upshot here is that the timeliness concern is driven by a need for security. We're trying to get HTTPS running over Tor, getting that working will sort of get the ecosystem cleaned up. There's a whole bunch of stuff that wants to use Tor, wants to use it. using existing application protocols over Tor and using existing secure modes of application protocols using Tor. I'll talk mostly about HTTPS because that has the most semantic implications in addition to ComSec implications. But there's also usage for SMTP and IM and general usage over SOX as well. So the idea of this is to, part of the idea of cleaning this registration up is to really fully enable the use of Tor as a secure transport for all sorts of different protocols at the application there. So let's talk about HTTPS. Little reminder about HTTPS. A lot of people think about HTTPS providing encryption and authentication, but really it provides a whole lot more than that. If you look at how the web, the overall process of rendering and interacting with the web page executes. So you get this suite of additional features besides the ComSec when you load an HTTPS page. The browser will block loading of mixed content. You get secure cookies. There's policy implications for other types of things as well. So if you use Tor, if you use HTTP over Tor with onion domains, you end up getting some of the properties, but still being vulnerable to a lot of the things that HTTPS is supposed to prevent. So you get some of the ComSec properties. You get some protection, especially on your local link, and some anonymization of your IP address. But you're still vulnerable to mixed content loading and things like that. So there's a desire for being able to run HTTPS over Tor. Well, what do we need to do that? Well, of course, HTTPS in all modern browsers requires the website to present a certificate to authenticate its domain name. So there's this need to have, if you're going to run HTTPS over Tor for a .onion name, you then need to have a certificate for that name. Now, the state we're in today is that we've got a handful of sites that have managed to get certificates for their .onion names through an exception that the CA Browser Forum had for local names, things that were not in the DNS, which this is not. These three sites in particular, for example, have gotten certs. This isn't really a sustainable path because the CA Browser Forum is eliminating this exception. Generally, a really good move. Cleaning up the PKI, removing certificates authenticating for local names, non-public names, generally improves the health of the PKI. Unfortunately, it means that these onion sites can no longer fall under these exceptions. They need to be sort of officially, declared in or out of the DNS. If they're in the DNS, then they follow the normal process for DNS authentication of DNS names. If they're out of the DNS, then they're handled as special non-DNS names or non-DNS resolvable names. So there's a hard deadline on this articulated in the CA Browser Forum's guidelines so that if as of October 1st of this year, CAs are required to revoke all of the certs that they may have issued under this local names exception, including the .onion ones. So all of these sites you saw on the previous slide, Facebook, some of these Bitcoin guys, The Intercept, those will all they'll lose the protections they've been getting from HTTPS, and they'll be back to operating HTTP over Tor. So this seems, in the sense of things like RFCC 7258 and the enabling more security technologies and more types of secure applications in the internet, this seems like a bad consequence. So I'm on the last slide. So the summary is, it seems like a good match. There's some bad consequences if we delay this and don't act. So the proposal here is to go ahead and adopt this draft. And contact information if you need to find the authors or if you want to talk to someone here at the ITF meeting, I'm here. Mark Nottingham is helping out as well, so feel free to find us.
Hi, I'm Stuart Cheshire from Apple, author of 6761. I think this is a good idea. I think this is appropriate use of that framework that's been put in place. An idea that's been emerging recently, which I think has been around for a long time, but hasn't been put into words very well, is this community here is curators of the DNS on the wire protocol, but also curators of the namespace for name resolution APIs and name reservation user interface. And there's great value in having the users be able to type a string into the web browser address bar and have that do DNS and other name resolution things in a consistent, understandable way. So I think that's a useful thing to do, and even though this does not affect the DNS on the wire protocol in any way and doesn't use the DNS on the wire protocol in any way, it is sharing that address bar in the browser. And that was what RFC 6761 was written to coordinate, and I think this is an absolutely perfect use of that to give a sane user experience and, as you say, sane certificate managing and all the things that go with that.
Before we continue with the mic line, we should have said earlier that in order to get to the things, to all of the documents we've promised time to, and because we are planning a meeting devoted to this, let's go ahead and get through the initial discussions we've planned, and then we'll take whatever time we still, you know, whatever time is left for comments. So I guess.
Can you want to go through the rest of the documents?
Yes.
The other two documents, and then.
Sorry, before. Can I just ask a clarification on a slide item?
Yes.
Okay, so go back two slides. One more. Yes. If Onion is not registered by October 1, can you explain what registered means?
Oh, yeah, registered in the sense of either, you know, either being an official TLD, which is not what's being proposed, or registered as a special use name. So it needs to be either, you know, sort of in the root zone for real, or declared to be not in the root zone. Yeah.
Okay, this is the draft that was described as patiently waiting. That would be a redefinition of patiently, I think, but that's fine. We've done it again here. Obviously, you heard about 6761. I won't repeat that. It was a good description in the previous presentation. It creates the special purpose registry for those sorts of names. We think that the draft here does comply with 6761. It's different from Onion in that it does talk about strings labels in the DNS. So it's something that, again, as Stuart talked about, it's going to be something that's applicable to the browser bar. But we're talking about now strings that we're trying to reserve that could be in the DNS. Okay. Well, so the three strings here are name, corp, and mail. Those are the reasons for doing these reservations are operational and engineering reasons. They are, all three of them are related to problems that a bunch of research has shown pretty decisively that there are operational issues with them, engineering issues, and so forth. In the slides, which you can get online in the working group, things and data tracker, the documentation for what the problems are pretty clear, and I've given some URLs, some pointers to the documentation, the reports that talk about, for instance, the problem with invalid labels that frequently appear as queries in the root. Those are the two that are very, very well understood there are home and corp. And of course, the discovery in 2013 of the name collision problem, and that has been talked about in a variety of research reports. That's very well documented, and .mail is the affected label in our draft there. This is a O2 draft. This draft has been around for quite a while. There are a bunch of editorial changes, and one of the things that we've been requested over the years is to actually reduce the number of labels that have been reserved. So the original draft that we wrote reserved 8, the second version reserved 6, and the current version just talks about these three specific labels. In terms of moving forward, Lyman and my draft have been around for a long time. We'd certainly like to move forward. We don't have a timeliness issue in the way that Dot Onion has, but on the other hand, these are operational concerns and engineering concerns that I think the community would, first of all, I think the community understands the issues pretty well, and then second of all, not only understands them, but supports the idea of actually doing this reservation. I kind of support Stuart's point about the IETF being a custodian of the namespace on the wire. I think that's well said. The authors are also supporting Suzanne's suggestion of having an interim discussion about the issues surrounding reserving names, how well 6761 works, and what to do sort of in a changed environment. And so the authors are fine with the idea of waiting until after that, although we do have some comments about that. We haven't gotten any feedback from people that there's any disagreement about these three names, because there is an awful lot of operational research that shows that they represent a problem. So there you can clearly see, no, you can't.
Sorry, Mark, I don't know.
It's okay. That's right. Okay.
And I think we had, was it Warren, I guess, on Alt?
I think you need Joel up there, actually.
Yeah, Joel has the magic touch.
Wow, I'm short. Yay! Good enough. So, I get the clicky thing. So this is going to be really short because we're low on time. The IETF ICANN MOU largely says that there are two allocation spaces that have lots of policy implications. This is domain names and IP addresses. So RIRs do IPs, and ICANN does stuff like domain names. We cleverly, though, reserve the right to allocate names for technical use or experimental uses. And that's kind of what the special use domain name stuff does. We've already had some discussion on what they are. But largely, you need different resolution behavior. And you know, it's supposed to require special handling and some new functionality. So this all sounds really good. So the problem comes in. There was this whole new GTLD thing. And there were 1,900 applications or so for around 1,400 strings. And there's been lots of excitement now about TLDs. And this brought up lots and lots of policy stuff and lots of politics. But the world seems to have decided that TLDs and things that look like TLDs have some sort of value or worth. Mm-hmm. And as I say, lots of policy stuff. You know, .wine, there's a whole bunch of craziness around who gets to have .wine, if anyone should. Kosher, you know, many different people can have kosher. As I say, you end up with like governments coming along, you end up with religious debates. This is the sort of thing that I don't think IETF wants to have. People who've been to an ICANN meeting will know this is not what we want. But you know, this isn't ICANN, these aren't TLDs. Except that people now seem to think that things like this are useful. We now have, I believe, 41 requests for 6761 names. Most of these are for things where a name gets used in a non-DNS context, sort of things kind of like Onion. And I guess just mention, I think Onion is obviously a great candidate for special use names, but there are lots of other ones that are coming along requesting this. Part of that, I think, is because there's no place for people to experiment with new namespaces or new resolution types. So what do we do about this? Well, what this document does not do, it does not deprecate 6761, it doesn't update it, it doesn't change any of the existing requests. This is not intended to solve everyone's problem. I realize it's not going to solve everyone's problem. What it does do, though, is it requests that .alt gets done as a special use name. I realize I'm saying, you know, we don't want too many of them, but here, give me one. What this is supposed to get you is NX domain if somebody looks things up. And now people who want to experiment with special use names or with sort of alternate resolution things can put their namespace under this. It's going to be completely unmanaged. Whatever software they have that implements the special resolution thing will match on their string.alt. If and when that leaks into the DNS,
it will be a special use name, and so resolvers should know to do an X domain. If they don't, you know, it will flow up until something does. And for many people, this will just be a place to experiment, get some experience, show that they actually have a user base. I mean, .onion can obviously show they have a lot of users, and that's, I think, something that's in its favor. And for many people, this could just be a permanent home. You know, if you want a new sort of resolution behavior, new namespace, just put it under here. There have been obvious questions about should we have a registry for this or not. My belief is no. Currently, there isn't really a registry for this. People just sort of pick a string that nobody seems to be using and use that. And I won't suspect that that was Peter was gonna beat me up about. And questions?
Yeah. Again, with my apologies to the people that wanted to speak before, we do have a few minutes, and we can. Yeah. For all three of these conversations. And again, we are planning a meeting devoted to this, and principally, you know, speaking just for myself, what I'm listening for here is guidance on how to make sure that larger discussion is
productive. And just checking, you want the other authors up?
Yes, please.
Okay, Peter Kordinik. I have a clarifying question to Warren in particular. So one of your observations was that people like TLDs.
Mm-hmm.
And what you're giving them is essentially a second level domain. Is that observation correct?
That's largely correct.
Okay.
So it's not really a second level domain, because that kind of implies that there's structure in the space. But yes, it will look to them like another space. One of the things the document suggests is possibly better than what you're trying to do is go and register a string, you know, example.com, and just go and experiment under that. There are some implications of doing that, though. A lot of the reasons people want to do this is for privacy reasons. You know, Onion is sort of an example of something where you want different behavior, you don't want it to leak. If you have something.example.com, then, you know, when your cache is empty, stuff flows up, hits example, you know, hits relical recursive, hits root, hits com, hits example. So, but yeah, you're right.
My question is here, did you do an attempt of an acceptance test with the proposed customer base?
Kind of, yes. And a number of people, surprisingly, were perfectly happy with trying under that. Yep, I spoke to some of the Onion people, and I'll say some of the Onion people, and they were like, that doesn't sound unreasonable. We might consider moving under that, which shocked me. But, you know, new people might be willing to do this.
Brian Dixon. I was just thinking sort of a meta thing about all the 6761 applications and how we deal with the DNS part of that. AS112, mm-hmm. The question is, should 6761 imply AS112? Should, and this is sort of an orthogonal question, should DNSOP recommend certain names that are not registered as top-level domains that are noise also get delegated as secure signed DNames with the new AS112 to get rid of that noise?
This doc has gone through a bunch of revisions, and at least one of them we said, you know, recursive should be authoritative for this, and so should drop it, you know, recursives. And then this should be delegated to AS112, then we pulled it up, then we put it in. I've got no idea what it says currently, but that seems like a perfectly good thing is, you know, these should go to AS112, the AS112 DName solution, not AS112.
And a third question that may be applicable to Onion is, if we recommend to whoever to get certain labels registered as AS112 delegations, does that meet the requirement for .onion to meet the deadline? Oh, AS112 is a way of delegating something that does not exist. It's an NX domain wildcard, effectively. The new version of it works for any new delegation without having any management. It's completely distributed. And the question is, if the root delegates to AS112 for certain labels like .onion, even before a 6761 gets approved, would that meet the requirements for the CAB? It's a question.
That was for you, not me.
Yeah. I would have to check the paperwork.
I mean, I mean, in order for it to be delegated to AS112, the IETF would have to tell IANA to please do that, which would require that it's done the 6761 stuff, and yeah. So that's problem solved. Is this for me or for him? Oh dear.
John Levine, 30 years ago, we did the same thing on Usenet. We had official news groups and we had alt news groups, which is where the name came from. And it, you know, and when I looked at it, I was like, and in fact, it works great. You know, any nitwit can set up an alt news group. Many nitwits do, and they work things out. And despite the fact that the namespace is totally unmanaged, since it's infinitely large, people pick something and it works. So I think. That suggests that even though this is one of those things that doesn't work in theory but does work in practice.
Christian Riedemann, Microsoft. About 10 years ago, we did a peer-to-peer naming system, PNRP. And basically what we did to solve that problem was actually reserve a second-level domain. So we had names of the form hash.pnrp.net.
Okay.
And there was no particular side effect.
Yeah, so I mean, this could all live under a real delegated domain.
Yeah, and the advantage of alt is that you preclude people doing a gateway to the DNS.
Yeah, that's the main difference. That's a fair bit of it, is yes. You know, this should never hit the DNS. People are going to implement their own weird resolution libraries.
But otherwise, the fact to have, I mean, many of those experiments, you don't actually need a top-level domain, it just looks cool.
Yes, although they all leak into the DNS.
They go into a DNS slot.
Yeah, people type it into their web browser, people email links to their
I understand that, but if you had something like onion.org, it would have worked too.
Yes, yes it would have.
Carver Range for IPNCC, I think it's a good idea, but I don't think it solves the issue that you brought up, because for almost all the names on 6761, the main driver, the main argument was this is already used a lot. So it doesn't stop people from. So I don't think that will stop having new requests for 6761.
So currently, to get a special use name, you need ISG approval or standards track. And, you know, there's this template that you fill in, and it's fairly easy to fill in the template and say you want special handling. When this reaches DNS ops or IESG or something, it would be nice if they could say, yeah, how about you go try it over there first, and once you can show you have millions of users, come back and try again. For many of the names, they are already legacy names, although I think that was when I looked and there were 7 or 12. There are now 41, I think, including this, and so I haven't looked at the other however many. I can't do math.
Yeah, last call for the mics. But I didn't close them yet, I just said last call.
So one observation on .alt, I think generally it's a fine idea. Characterizing it as completely unmanaged might not be the most useful thing. You may get some bang for your buck out of a very simple registration system. We were chatting about this earlier, we proposed having something like first come, first serve with duplication allowed. I think, as John pointed out, people will naturally try and avoid collision with, especially with popular stuff. So if we provide, it would be helpful if we could provide some tools to help people avoid collision.
And yeah, so that sounds like a great thing. One concern is the whole trademark issue. But I have a question for you as the .onion person, or a statement.
Okay.
So I think the .onion thing is really useful. Something which you didn't mention, which I think is a great side effect of having a special use name, is lots of onion names are used for confidential stuff. Mm-hmm. And doing it as special use means that those don't flow up the normal resolution path. They don't hit the root. They get squashed immediately, so that's a win.
Yeah, yeah. So keeping there's benefits both from the client side and the name server side, right? Because you prevent bogus queries and you prevent information leakage. And obviously the benefit you get from that will be proportional to the implementation of this draft, but
Everything
we could have done as a standards organization.
Find or do this by default and the standard distribution, it's all good.
Yeah. Stuart Cheshire. I think there's an unspoken assumption, at least some of the time, that people are conflating special use names with special use top level names. And the title of the RFC doesn't say top level. It's true that .local and .home and things like that are pseudo TLDs. But the spirit of the document does not assume they're top level at all. the spirit of the document is names that ought to be recognized by the software and handled differently. So to that end, using onion.net doesn't solve the problem. We still want it recorded as a special use name so that the resolver library knows not to put it into the DNS and the local recursive resolver knows not to try to resolve those queries. So the specialness of the name is not changed by pushing it down a level. That's a comment to other things that people have said. To your document, yes, I support that. I think having .alt as a playground where you can freely experiment with stuff, knowing that .alt is already black-holed in compliant resolvers. And the other reason for having RFCs under the 6761 framework is that if I, representing an operating system vendor, or if Netgear or D-Link want to black-hole those queries, they need some document to point to that authorizes that black-holing, otherwise they're just acting independently.
So I've got a question for you, and it's probably a really bad idea, but you said it doesn't imply the top level. Does this mean that I could say, we will reserve Fusel what's it, dot, and then you could put anything after that?
The RFC intentionally left that unspecified.
let's not go there. I just... yeah.
The important requirement for the special use framework is that the names be programmatically recognizable algorithmically. Now, having a particular name, a particular label at the top level is one very reliable way of doing algorithmic recognition. I didn't want to shut the door on other proposals. Of course, if there were another proposal, the community would have to consider it very carefully. But at this moment, that was not explicitly ruled out.
Woohoo! namespace.www.something.onion.
Colon.
Yeah. Colon.
But I agree with your
thank you.
First comment, which is that barring some very surprising argument, it seems unlikely that that would be viable.
Andrew Sullivan, this is a question for people to think about before the interim meeting. Somebody just suggested that there be a registration protocol for the alt space. Are you really sure that you want to have an IANA registry for names managed by the IETF and a different IANA registry for names managed by ICANN and the potential politics for those two things? So I'm not entirely sure that you want that. We don't have to answer that now, but consider it as fodder for the interim.
My personal view, because I thought about this a while, is no, we really don't want that registry. Currently, people choose strings sort of at the top that don't seem to be used. I think that's what they should do here, but that's just my view.
Yeah, I think that's the be careful what you wish for sort of idea.
Yeah, one more.
Okay.
In the spirit that anybody can do anything, I think there's no reason for the IETF to do that. If some random person wants to have a voluntary registry, go ahead. We don't care.
Huh. Okay. That's a good point.
Okay, thanks. We'll be working on... Yeah, we'll be...
Okay.
So we will be working on scheduling that. We will be working on agenda and some of these questions for the interim. Thanks, everybody, for the comments, for the input.
Thanks, everyone. This draft is basically a survey report on the DNS caching recursive service. Actually, the motivation is we have this idea in a workshop of DNS future architecture, which held in last December in Hong Kong. During the discussion, we found that it seems that recursive servers bears more and more functions, and of course it brings some merits to improve the end user experience, but it definitely brings some negative impact for the authoritative operators. I will explain it. So after the meeting, we did some survey in China. Okay. Traditionally, there were three biggest ISPs providing the recursive service in China, and they occupy over 90% market share. But in the recent years, there are newcomers, you know, providing the public recursive DNS services like Alibaba, like 114 and Qihu. Actually, and we got a new architecture. All of these ISPs, companies, and these content traditional content service companies, they change their recursive model into this one. We call it the big recursive service. It consists of independent backup server, independent analyzed cache, and independent recursive service. Okay, the cache that covering multiple regions and you know, trying to decrease the latency and improve the end user experience. And of course, some the data in the cache is some are pre-fetching data. And recursive service is just become a simple data fetching tool. And for the backup servers, it will store the most recently visited NS record, maybe top 1 million or top 5 million, and some important zone files, including the root and some important TLDs. So I think obviously there are merits. It improves the performance and spreads the risk by separating the cache function from the recursive. And some cache servers are only visible within ISP or within the local LAN. And emergency response. In the case of emergency, the backup server will be activated and provide the the data to the cache. And the DNSSEC, yes. Most of the stuff or in China they don't support DNSSEC, but the cache could prefetch or initiate a DNSSEC request. For the China Telecom, yes, they did it. For the Alibaba, yes, they did it too. They support and client subnet, and they do the prefetch before the TTL expires. For the 114, yes, they do. They did it too. Though they don't support the EDNS client subnet draft, they're trying to work together with the CDN by forwarding the request to some local. Regional recursive agent. Anyway, what I want to emphasize is that the negative impact to the DNS ecosystem, especially on the authority of operators, first, it declines the number of queries arriving at the authority of server. Actually, let's take DOCN for example. For the past 10 years, the internet cities in China increased from 50 million to 500 million. But the query number for DOCN only increase, it only doubles. But there are interesting statistics that the percentage of the query from China mainland for DOCN decreased from two-third to one-third, which means on average, the every recursive servers handles more requests, the second one is it distorts the query behavior and aesthetics at the authoritative server. The packets reach recursive server are not all triggered by stubs. It's obviously and so the aesthetics doesn't mean anything. I mean, the third one is it cut the authoritative queries number to zero in emergency. Sometimes when the backup servers were activated, so for the authoritative servers. The queries from that area just disappears. It becomes a black hole. So my conclusion is that the role of recursive server is becoming more important and complicated. And the market has made a choice. I mean, in China, there are now seven monopoly companies which occupies over 99% of the market share. So the current rough solutions bring some unexpected problems. The cooperation mechanism and technical extension might be needed For example, here is some personal suggestions or topics I think might be needed to study further. First is, if it is reasonable that cache and recursive query packets carry some optional information to authoritative, like the query amount for given domain name during the before the TTL expires. It is a request initiated by cache or initiated by stub, or the local stub number of the recursive server. The second is the backup server notify the authoritative before or after emergency. You know, try to tell the authoritative server what's going on over there. And the third one is maybe a local shared backup server agent is needed. It should be trusted by a multiple local recursive operator, and it should be trusted by the some important authoritative operators like TOB or root, and it will trying to maintain a latest zone file from the authoritative servers. So that's it. Your comments are wise, and also we want to know if it doesn't really make sense to make a further study or test. Like, for example, Alibaba and China Telecom has agreed to help to try to deploy some prototype to see how different it could be, or how different the operation, the traffic data and the statistics it will be at the authoritative server side. Thanks. That's all.
Thank you.
Paul Hoffman, so one quick question. I mean, it looks, even though most people don't consider the cache and the recursive that different, but you have them separated here, one thing I would love to find out is how often are those emergency backup servers actually used? I assume you're trying to keep them sort of up to date, and all of us try to keep offsite backups and whatever, but you had asked what would be good to know more. Not, I can understand how I would make a backup server. What I want to know is, are they ever used?
Maybe in the past a couple of years, once a year, I think. Because last year, there's DNS traffic attack, something like that. The China Telecom and China Unicom will try to activate their backup servers once a year. Last October, and I think in 2012, maybe in August, something like that.
Okay. Faber, one question. Have you actually measured that there is a significant improvement for the users by doing that?
If we want to do that, I need the help from Dossi and to ask them to provide some DNS log to me.
Yeah. And the other, how would that system work in case of a domain where there is random names asked repeatedly in a zone because you can't cache all of them, or?
It's just interesting that I asked the China Unicom, one of the third biggest ISP in China. They cached or they stored the historically visited NS record in their cache, which is over 100 million NS record.
Yeah, but the NS record is not the problem. I mean, you're asking random string dot something domain, and basically for every random string first label, the server has to go out to the authority of server and ask it, or?
I'm sorry, could you pardon?
Yeah,
could you repeat the question?
Yeah, you can't get that record in the cache because the record is sort of randomized. It's a random first label for, say, any domain that you want to DOS. And I was wondering how would that system kind of work in the way when there is such an attack? You have tons of queries with unique random labels.
Sorry, excuse me. Dr. Yan, could you answer the question?
Okay. It sounds like you guys need to buy each other beer.
Okay.
And then tell
we'll
us
just
about the answer.
I'm sorry.
No, I'm fascinated, and yeah. Thank you. And I hope to see more discussion on the list and some support. Especially, I was especially happy when I reviewed this document that has empirical data in it about how things are actually working in the real world. So thank you very much.
Hello, I'm Kazunori Fujiwara from JPRS. And Akira Kato and I submitted draft Fujiwara DNS of NSEC Aggressive Use 00. And it tries to decrease queries using DNSSEC. Section 4.5 of RFC 4035 defines initially a resolver could use wildcards or NSEC errors to generate positive and negative responses until the TTL or signatures on the records in question expire. However, it seems prudent for resolvers to avoid blocking new authoritative data or synthesizing new data on their own. Resolvers that follow this recommendation will have a more consistent view of the namespace. So we shouldn't generate negative response from the cached NSEC RR. So our draft proposes to relax this restriction. And this is possible. There are possible benefits of the proposal. DNSSEC is just security anymore. With this proposal, DNSSEC will reduce DNS strike, which was increased by DNSSEC. And DNSSEC will reduce the damage of random subdomain attacks, water torture attacks significantly. And DNSSEC will reduce queries to root DNS servers by type, mistake, and some attacks. And DNSSEC will reduce average RTT to end resolvers. And this is an idea of an aggressive use of NSEC, NSEC 3. A full resolver responds NX domain error when the name in question is covered by NSEC or NSEC 3 in the negative cache. And a full resolver responds no data when QNAME exactly matches NSEC, NSEC 3 and QTYPE doesn't exist in the type bitmap. The matching procedure applicable to all ancestor domain names of the query name. And the full resolver is required to check existence of a wildcard. And wildcard expansion is also possible. And there are considerations. The purpose of RFC 4035 sentence is to avoid blocking new authoritative data or synthesizing new data on their own. With this proposal, newly registered resource records may not be used immediately. But inconsistency concern can be mitigated by limiting effective max TTL. RFC 2308 suggests 1 to 3 hours and even 300 seconds. This proposal could reduce queries under random subdomain attack scenario. And there are other notes. This technique is called as NSEC NSEC 3 aggressive negative caching in unbound to-do file since release 0.4 September 2007. And unbound has aggressive negative caching code in its DLV validator since release 1.1.0 November 2008. And I tested NSEC aggressive caching using unbound DLV validator code with small patch. And the idea seems to work well to mitigate attacks, random subdomain attacks, and reduce queries to root. And is this proposal useful? And please comment. That's all.
Have you submitted the patch back to Unbound?
Yes.
Okay.
Very good.
So
this is a new draft, and it's a complex discussion, so we hope to see more discussion on the list.
But less volatile than the NSEC 5 discussion seems to be.
This is much more useful.
Yes.
John Levine, in RFC 5782, I described how you do DNS blacklists and whitelists for IPv6, which is horrible because each address turns into a domain name. And yeah, okay. And so 2 years ago, I came to this group and suggested doing this so that, like, if I'm doing a whitelist lookup and it's between two other things that I've already checked, I could synthesize it. And I was advised, paraphrasing slightly, that I was stupid. So I'm glad to hear that the group has become stupider in the meantime.
Or you've gained more intelligence along the way.
But I still think the same thing.
Okay, so yeah. That's true. So okay, we've gained intelligence.
Yeah, so anyway, so I can say I have one concrete application for which this would be a big win.
Okay, cool.
Okay, so we have one more quick item.
There we go. Sorry. I knew I was looking at it earlier, so my bad.
I'm going to talk a little bit about ADNS compliance and as it is today. The motivation for this is we were deploying SIT or DNS cookies, our experimental version in Bind 9.10, and there's a lot of bad misimplementations out of EDNS out there in the world, and lookups with cookies turned on failed. So while we're doing, when we looked at this, I decided to look at not only EDNS cookie EDNS options, which cookies is just one, but lots of other EDNS extensions. Working around the errors takes trial and error, and that takes time. We just don't have that when we're doing a recursive lookup. You can make some heuristic adjustments, but not all of them are nice, and you get absolutely random garbage coming back at you. So there have definitely been proposals for turning on not only cookies but other EDNS options, and there have been proposals with EDNS flags. And so we did a bit of measuring out there. I used these 5 data sets. The root, looked at all the servers of the root in the root zone, listed in the root zone. The Alexa top 1,000, Alexa bottom 1,000, top million. All the Gov servers in the Alexa top 1 million, that's got a lot of DNSSEC there, and because I'm from Australia, I looked at the Australian ones. We did this with just regular queries using DIG. There's a couple of extensions there which will be in 9.11 when it comes out. They are available via Git at the moment. So nice simple queries, we did them all in parallel to the service and then looked at the answers. We detected these sorts of errors. Whole heap of them, and these are just the EDNS ops, and I've got a RFC draft discussing all this. First of all, we actually have pretty good EDNS awareness out there, so we've got some nice figures there, and this is EDNS awareness over time. It is improving. There's most of those, the slope is up to the right, which is a good thing. But when we actually look at how individual servers behave for specific types of queries, we can see there's a lot of misimplementation. The blue line there is just a plain EDS query with no flag bit set or anything else. We also looked at to see whether the EDNS response, the opt record was returned in a truncated response, which is the red bar. DNS set query, that's EDNS 0 plus the DO bit. That actually gets better behavior than a plain EDNS 0 because there are implementations out there which don't respond with an EDNS response unless the DO bit is set. Unknown query, unknown option. This is what would happen if you were to do DNS cookies today. We're looking at failure rates up to about 15%.
I'm Jared Mont from NTT. The truncated response, did they return the correct answer after truncate?
I was just looking to see whether they returned a truncated response and it had the opt-in record in it. And if you set an unknown, if you send an unknown flag bit, which is the one under the green one, and if you try and do EDNS version negotiation, it gets even worse. And the fully compliance, we're getting down to the 60% fully compliance down there. So that's the historical data. So this is the responses to EDNS, unknown EDS options correctly over time. And an unknown EDS, one option. And then we've got the response rates. So we've got firewalls out there that think that EDNS one query is not a good thing to actually answer. Or an unknown flag, you set a flag bit, we're not going to answer this. I don't know what they're trying to protect, but they're really annoying because you really, it takes time to recover from them. And this is the unknown option, at least the root at the TLD level we're going pretty well, but when you get down further you get different errors and timeouts, and most of them are going okay, but these are the response rates. They're getting worse, unfortunately. So yes, people, and I suspect most of that's due to the scrubbing services trying to protect, and the scrubbing services not doing a good job. And apart from the roots, those ones are going better. Now that's an unknown flag. And this is a more detail that we've got a lot more detail online. So these are how the individual failure modes for an EDNS one query. We've got the timeouts in the red line. The green line is it's returning the wrong status. In this case, the name servers are totally ignoring the EDNS version and just returning an answer as if it was EDNS 0, so no negotiations going on. The orange line is a name server which set bad version but also returned the answer. Most of those have been fixed after talking to the vendor in turn. And there's more you can go try things. This is an unknown flag. That red line got fixed after talking to the vendor involved. is reflecting back the eDNS flag, which was specifically prohibited and unknown. And we've got the timeouts, which is the firewall there, which if we could get rid of that, would be nice. This is actually not too bad. You're looking at down there one or two servers for that one at the TLD level. At the other data sets there it's worse, but you can look at them online. And this is the type of firewall behavior you were seeing. That drop down was when I changed the characteristics and added more separation. So I've got this draft, like comments back on it. We need to try and contact firewall vendors to make them actually say that EDNS 1 is not actually dangerous to go through, and similarly with EDNS flags. We need to contact name sort of vendors to try and fix this. Zone owners. We've got some TLD operators and SLD operators checking their, doing the same thing just so we can get some more data. And we want to get some online DNS checkers so people can check their own servers. Switch has got data for CH and LI, and Ireland is about to start doing the testing. And there's some places to find more data, more information, and more detailed reports.
Terrific. The slides are posted, and there's actually some really good data in here. We will have to take that to the list, or take Mark to the bar. But
I think we hit the wall of time. So we've got some stuff to follow up on the mailing list. If there's anything else, just come out and reach out to us, sort of thing. But thanks for everything, and we kind of kept things actually sort of right on schedule, which was surprising. And we hope, and do your document reviews so you make Paul happy. And we'll plan on the interim meeting in a few weeks. So we'll start working that process.
I'm going to get Jared.
Oh, yeah, Jared, get your sticker. So, and I think Mark.
Happy birthday, Suzanne.
Thank you.
Happy birthday to you.
Ben!
There you go.
I wasn't kidding when I said I got the IV from my birthday.
Pardon.
the white box, whatever. Yeah.
So now it's a bit, it requires some refactoring. And now that I have my ideas, I just find it only one way to do things. Everything else will be in a pentagon. Okay, you can do this if you want.
Oh, absolutely, good point.
But that seems to be much harder. And if you can touch back into it, that would be nice.
And does that have to be
all in one?
Yes,
early arrived.
Trying to present the tunnel to make a right to flex the